Okay, we this just no, it's an informal Q&A. We just we love it after 10 years. After 10 years, people are still talking about the movies and talking about your product. So how do you feel about that?
It's really good. it started out as a very small project in 2005, 2003, 2004. I was actively involved in more television advertising, film works that was either in for Malay market or a Chinese market, and at that time I felt that it was good to share a story of my own community, but I was not so sure where to start. And a lot of people told me there was no necessity in such because we had a lot of good Bollywood films, a lot of Tamil films coming from India. As you're aware, this isn't Kuch Kuch Hota Hai with Shah Rukh Khan. And so it's also not Kabali with Rajinikanth. And also not The Wolf from Wall Street. A Malaysian film indeed, yeah. So it was a challenge, you can imagine, in 2005, pitching an idea as this, and also putting a team of very dedicated crew and cast together. And no, I had no, my dreams wasn't this far. At that time, we just wanted to get the ball rolling and get it done, do the best we could, and release it on silver screens. That's the lie I told my cousin crew at that time, that this movie I'm making is going to the cinema. Actually, I had no contract from cinema. So that was the biggest lie I did at the time. I told everybody it's going to be a cinema movie, so everybody turned up and said, wow, you know. So luckily we got into cinema, yeah. Homegirl, 13 January 2005, yeah. So it's a very memorable day, so thank you.
Yeah, I've seen the poster, the black and white. And
yeah,
so it's the right. In Indian film without a singing and dancing.
that was a disaster for any marketing campaign at that time. also the cinema, with this film, it had a lot of challenges. But not only the cast and crew played a very important role in staying by the production, not letting go, you know, the belief and hope that this would get done. It was very important. They stand by it. It's a lot of time it could have just cut off. It was we took months rehearsing. We scripted a lot, the script, we storyboarded the film. We had a lot of discussion. 70-80% of the cast and crew. The crew itself wasn't Indian. We had a Chinese producer, music composer was Punjabi, sound guy was Malay. He was a lot of time, you know, Wangade was this. Betul ke sound? Betul lah, nampak okey lah kan? Everything was live sound, yeah. Everything was live sound, live shot. Nothing was post-produced. We didn't have the facilities at that time to do that. So everything was going, we improvised on set. The motorbikes really did not start. Couldn't find a replacement for that era and time. We dealt with it, so turned out to be very nice. So the lorry always broke down. The house, it was a house built by the British for the rubber estate community at that time, and it didn't have a roof. So every table chair was put together by leftover wood or pieces of doors that we started to put and build together to make it look and feel as that time of era would be. The cast and crew got their hands dirty building stuff, so even the actors. We stayed in the estate for some time. We a lot of those communities that you see from in that characters in that film were real people. A lot of those were real people who was very supportive. And all this put together, it was very important that the commitment went down. And that what made the magic of this film. It was really the people behind it, the willingness. I remember, I think you recall, there's a scene where they asked Indra Ravi, with Shanta. That was my first experience when I drove the car into the estate and trying to find people. And I asked somebody, do you know this person because I need to get something? And they asked, there was like 20 of them same name. So their father's name would be the same. So all this thing improvised. We improvised and we went and it somehow worked for us, thankfully. Yeah,
interestingly because most of them are non-professional.
There is no professional.
No,
we don't have Rajini Khan doing. So we didn't have. We are small. I mean, Malaysian cinema is a small cinema, but has a very, very long, strong history. It doesn't have the stardom or the studio system as what Hollywood or Bollywood have. So it was a lot dependent on people who are really passionate and interested and believed in a vision. Do something.
Yeah. So on the subject matter of the life and the rural areas, I think it's interesting because of the village life. Actually, it's kind of we kind of know, but we didn't know much. Yeah, something like it's a secluded as we live in the city right now. Right? We didn't see that every day. So what? Yeah, what kind of an inspiration behind the choosing the subject matter for your first film?
It's a very good question. What happened was I was producing quite a number of telemovies and also films in different languages because again, it's a Malay market here in Malaysia. We get more audiences and of course you get a bit more returns because of the market size. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a very segmented industry. You have the Malay, Chinese, Indian. So thinking of doing something for the minority or thinking of something out of the way, it's a big risk. With my friend from advertising said, you're going into the black hole and Deepak come out. Why are you doing that, so a lot of people don't do it. But one thing that really drove me was, you see, every time I also was given small roles to act and to play in Malay films. Mm-hmm. And usually the roles that they gave me was penyanga, penyamun, perompa, pencuri. If I translate that in English, usually robbers, thief. Because it's an Indian guy, he must be a robber, he's going to steal my money. So I remember one Christmas, many years back, they dyed my hair green. He said, now you're a robber. I said, no Indian gangster would dye their hair green. It's a moving target. But it's still so stereotypical on television, So I used to get those kind of assignments, and I was just going to do it. Like, you look Indian, so you're going to steal somebody's money. You might as well do it, isn't it? So you've got a good role, bro, then. Or you would be a dark-skinned Malay actor who would call himself Tambi. so because they had a Tambi comedy character in that Malay film, so it's usually those characters. So I thought, why not show the other side of my people? Of course, you Google the internet, you see high crime rates or school dropout, death by poisoning and whatever. So I felt I had friends, I had family, I had brothers, sisters, who I felt have different side of story to share. So that was all this building up in me. I felt these characters needed more depth, these characters needed more voice, it needed a platform. And so I challenged that thought. And so I started thinking about it. And where to find your inspiration, coming back to your gravel route. Where to find your inspiration, I started reading a lot on history, a lot on the community has been in Malaysia. Because anywhere you go, until today, my office means things, I'm from India. So makes it quite easy, so you're international. So the film released in Malaysia is international again. And they thought it was international film, but it's fully 100% cast and crew Malaysian. So what happened was, it's a good achievement, but at the same time, it's ironic. I read a bit in Malaysian film, but it looked as international. Why? Am I a foreigner? It's very strange. So that all those build up. So where do you find your source of self-discovery? It was a question where my friend from hip hop, half my friend from hip hop, just couldn't fit. I didn't feel hip hop-ish at that time. So I was a rapper also. So I didn't know what as an Indian I was being in Malaysia. Very confusing times. So all my life I only know Malaysia. So it was very confusing. I was trying to find my identity also. So at that time, I find where else ask your mother. And your mother will lecture you a long time, my time, I had to walk through this estate, it was, no, I didn't have the luxury of what you have, and all those challenges, I put up with all that. Like, 50 cents, I could survive the whole year, you know. So I put up with all that, I thought, since she's good, you know, it's already a moving screenplay there, I might as well take notes. So I started taking notes, and I realized there's a lot of stuff in there. That actually I wasn't paying attention to it. So it was more of observation and listening and talking and listening. And that helped me actually find these little ideas where the gem, you know, the real thing of that, I could find a subject matter that I felt would be worthwhile. It was very important that I found a purpose in doing the product. And I think this is a product, the film is a product. And the product had to have a life cycle, it had to have that values in it. If I had to represent the community, I had to represent, we had a responsibility to write it. And that became the ultimate, more bigger aim that inspired all the other aspects of it, the acting, the cinematography, the music, all original. And this, that was the foundation. How you want to portray this, the wide, really, we call it very, very wide, long shot stand. Disaster for television. Television will be fine. Where is the head of the actor? So you know, people were advising me such long shots, such wide shots. But the intention was, it was a postcard. I felt each shot was a postcard. It was a recollection of memories. And so all this idea came from that root cause. Finding yourself, discovery, finding yourself, being what it takes to be an Indian, what it takes to be a Malaysian. How does the community look at you? What is the stereotype behind it? And the whole cast, the crew, the art director was Chinese, Sylvia Ong. She could pick up more stuff as an Indian. I couldn't. She would say, you know, you Indians put like that, they will brush the colorful. So I said, I'm sure, yeah. Okay, the cinematographer was Chinese. So they could see, and this go and back of ideas, which is what really made the film.
I really love the shot that you, you know, the how you portray the character in there. The one, yeah, I think one scene that I really remember when Shanta come home, want to eat, and then his sister Lalita first scolded her, and then there's her sister came in without any much of a dialogue, just total silence, and then there's a little sister sleeping. I thought this was a powerful how to portray actually the. I think that the complexity and all this emotion actually is coming in on the screen. You just remind me of the Japanese director Ozu, which is Sujiro Ozu. Mm-hmm. A lot of camera static. It's not a lot of movement, but everything is happening in that screen, and there's no holding back. Everything's happening there.
Yeah,
so I really love that, and so you are thinking through all that on that, you know, kind of how to get that emotion out of the, and then yeah, to my surprise, it was non-professional. So it's really, and the take so long. So how to communicate?
Yeah, my cinematographer was shaking on the camera. So dude, is it not cut yet? No, bro. Got another 20 seconds. Lalita is smiling there, she knew. Why is this guy not saying anything, and why is the camera still rolling? What are we supposed to do on frame? So just stay, you know, be in whatever you're doing. So it was a whole excitement there, was that a lot of things were not needed to be said, scripted, necessarily. The emotions and the situation, you know, the settings that put into place was already quite, I felt, had the depth. And I believed my audience were able to pick it. I had to believe on my audiences. A lot of people told me, you know, you have to literally explain things, you have to literally say things, you have to literally show those camera angles, angry, zoom in, zoom. I don't think so. I believe it's not necessary. And that, I think, helped the film. And it helped the film, and thanks to the cast, they understood the depth of each of the characters, and they were able to pull it through. Yeah.
Yeah, because of the characters, although the only Shanta is center, but you can see all the characters that you are, you know, growing in you. You know them actually throughout the movie. That's the thing that I think because right now, when the invention of you know, the soap opera and all these cable Netflix, Netflix and all that, and people rely on dialogues more. Just like Avengers, everything. More dialogue. You know already, but they tend to, you know, explain to you. Just like, I know already why you explain to me. Something like that, yeah. And then, not all the, you know, we have a few films like this. Even in film too, it kind of a cut. And it's so you know, fast cut and all that. So, yeah. And then I tried to, you know, watch your next movie,
yeah,
in 2006,
right? 2007.
2007, sorry. The Chaalangai.
Chaalangai.
Dancing Bell, actually. Which is, I think it's on that same, actually, themes, but different, different places, communities, a big thing.
The thing about, I felt about the setting, the setting itself, the estate, the people, the pace was set by the setting. And Brickfield is a two-film ballgame altogether. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Talking about 2007, halfway KL Central, halfway whatsoever is happening in the place. It already has its own past history, characters, and you know, it's a very unique town for me. So that had a different pace, different feel. So you know, each of it is treated quite differently, because this, like I said, it all builds towards the to the theme itself. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, what do you think about now, the present, the cinema, the future of cinema?
Oh, this is a big question for me to answer. But
your personal, perspective.
It's a very big question to answer. What I can say is only from what the experiences we did was we had a different environment at that time. I mean, the whole, you know, how do I say it, an economic time or industry where technology was new. This film was in the infant stages of digital at that time. So some things I had to work with, because at that time all cinemas were running only on film. And so shooting on digital was a big issue, because cinema did not have digital projectors at that time. Mm-hmm. So, but I had to take the risk. And also Panasonic, thank you to Panasonic. At that time they came in and did a full sponsor for us on equipment, which then I said, okay, things are from Japan, let's test this, they want to use the footages. So it was very important for me to make sure those quality of that visual, because I've been, the perception of the audience of Malaysian films were not good. So they would pick on any single detail. Look at the quality, look at the color, look at that, look at this. So the perception, it was very important for me to maintain the quality, but I didn't have the capacity to shoot on film. So on digital, I need to be extra careful. Every single screening we've released on 24 countries, I made sure I went into the projection room. In cinema, when it opened in GSC, nearly every screening I walked into the projectionist room and I would sit behind. They would think you're a new technician here. Then after some time, I said, what are you doing? I'm looking at the quality of screening. I wanted to run before the audience walked in. So why? To make sure every single thing is right on there on the screen. And Azzad has the experience. I've been harassing from the last few days. I make sure the screen is working well, make sure the audience is going to be, make sure everything. I've been a control freak like this in everywhere. And when I went to San Francisco, the guy, I walked into the projectionist, and then the guy asked me, what are you doing here? Are you a new technician? Yeah. Run it. So he ran it. And I said, run it. The audience are waiting out there. So I ran it. I said, the quality is okay. Check on this button, check on that button. Okay, go. And then they asked me, what are you doing here? I'm from Malaysia. You're Indian. So yeah, I'm from Malaysia. So it's, is this an Indian film or a Malaysian film? It's a Malaysian film. You know, quite challenging to explain. So every part of the world we went, we released in Japan, we released in France, we released in Brazil. We went back to Delhi itself, we won an award there. So everywhere it went, you know, it was very interesting to see the audiences. And so bringing back, it's not much changed, I think, over the years. We still are finding our identity. We're still finding out what is Malaysia is about. We still see clustered, segmented industries. and nothing much has changed. In fact, the distributor at that time who introduced Lee Mei Fang, she saved my film. So what happened was she really helped me to get into Astro at that time. Astro had doubts. You might as well take India movie, you know, why you want to screen yours? And you're getting so much a call and harassment running your film on the Malaysian Indian film in town. So by that time she helped her. She told me, Deepak, you know, it'll take 10 years for your film to mature at this rate. Yeah, I said, really? I don't have 10 years, you know, I'm gonna raise it soon. She said, it'll take 10 years to mature, you see what happens. I didn't believe, I thought she was just another one, you know, being pessimistic here. She's right, lah. It's 12 years now. I'm still working on it. And yeah, so it's interesting. We have a lot of ways to go, yeah.
Yeah, for your information, is this movie has several awards, I think, yes. Several awards, the best alternative film, Anugerah Screen TV 3, right? And then special jury awards on Nantes Festival Three Continents in France. And then been screening all over the world for the festivals, 48 San Francisco International Film Fest, Rotterdam International Film Fest in Netherlands. So, okay, now we open up for the audience if you have any, you know, questions, curiosity, or else. So we can straight to the director. Yeah, please.
I'd like to ask, could you share more about the filming process, like how to direct children, and because children could be very hard to direct, and the chemistry between the family members, it has to be convincing. So how do you do that? And so the second question is, a comment. So just a comment, because my mom tells me the same stories of the rubber estate. So I find a lot of similarities, like the kerosene lamp, yes, and the accident actually, and how they used to live, like come out at night. So I really like that, because I wanted to write a script on rubber estate, on my mom's story. Mm-hmm. So I find it very inspiring, because I was stuck on, like, don't know how to talk about all these things without being pretentious or too fictional. So I really like it, and I like the way you do it modestly and very realistically.
Thank you. Thank you. I didn't get your name, Miss.
Ting. T-E-N-G. Ting.
Ting. Thank you, Ting. Yeah. Okay, same issue I had back then. I will probably have tomorrow also if I need to do anything. The most important thing is I call it orientation. So what I did was, every single character, we call for audition. I was not given any script. I just looked at them and said, hi, welcome. Have you heard about this film? Yes. So, okay. Tell me a bit about yourself. Tell me a bit on, something about you do. So a lot of those writing, initially what I had an idea was then molded into that person that I wanted to work with, right? And so that helped me, because the pretentious part was not necessary already. And at that time, nearly everyone that walked into my office came from the estate. Everyone, nearly everyone. They had an experience coming from the estate. They had a family, you know, or the grandmothers were from the estate, or the parents were from the estate. It was so instantaneously to connect with it. So it made a lot of sense for me to work on that. And it gave me more motivation. I know this product would work, because it's a fact that, you know, they already had their emotional connection to the content. That was one. Secondly, children. That girl that you see later featured as the main character in my second film, the small girl. My mother's a Tamil school teacher. So my mother brought a lot of Tamil school children for everybody. So it was like a playground in the office. I was like, sit down, sit. I said, no, I'm changing my mind now, you know. So anyway, it's a lot of children. And so this girl in particular, very interesting. So I said, come. I said, okay. She was the top student in my school. My mother was the principal in that school, I believe. She was a teacher. I'm not too sure, but at a point, she was a top student. She was a top student. Darshini Shankar. And she was very bright. She, throughout the shoot, she remembered everybody's script around her. She would forgot your line. She just read everything in there. She'll remind me, man. So yeah, it helped. So and she was so committed to be in it. So it didn't make sense, you know. And the only thing I asked her during the audition was, tell me a story. She told me a Ugly Duckling story. There was one that
so you featured in the film.
And I said, great, record, roll that. So yeah, it was like that. It was, I hope the tip helped for you. It was very important that when we did the audition processes, in that process, that you felt the character would add a lot of value into what you're doing. And so it takes a lot of time briefing or debriefing. The second aspect, of course, was the style. Right? You can see that I have a very strong style in this film. Personal touch to the shots, personal touch to the type of timing for scripts, the long, very wide shots. Actors would be, we would be like, you know, two rooms away. They'll be acting here and they'll ask, are you seriously recording or you're pulling a fast one? You're so far away from the subject. What am I going to be going? Dude, are they really running? I can hear them because they're wearing a wireless. I can hear them from the bush, you know, they're pushing the bike. Are they really making a sweat or are they recording? We'll be having a tea in the back there. Run, continue. You're still in scene. So now, to calibrate everybody to understand what exactly we are doing, because they don't get to see the screen. They don't get to see your visuals, but they know they're running across a path, right, for a long time. So we did an orientation, we ran a film, and one of my biggest source of inspiration was Azzad Diah, right, the Apu's trilogy at that time. Ho Yu Hang brought me his collection of stash of CDs, and I felt he was perfect. Azzad Diah was perfect for the type of film I'm seeing, because Azzad Diah was trying to bring his community, small community in Bengal, to share about the experience of his community to the world, when many parts of the world did not know what this community was about. And I felt the same connection of what I was trying to do, and I looked at his film and said, interesting. It seems the same theme. He's trying to share about this community, you know, but not for himself, not for his community, because they know it, or they feel they know it. But to what the proof here is today, we have a lot of community from different diversity here. So that's what we wanted to do. So I ran these films to all the cast and crew every night after work or whatsoever. They came in and they sat and watched it. Of course, they were like, man, we ain't gonna do this. Isn't this Bollywood? I said, no, you're not watching anything hip here. Try watching this type of film. So we pre-selected the film, they watched it, then we had a Q&A session after that, the scenes or that film. So it's sort of calibrated. Hey, look, this film is going to look like this, I think, you know, and because they didn't have film education or experiences to that extent. So we, as a filmmaker, you need to share that. You need to give them references, but they will build the character for me. That makes sense to you?
Yes.
Yeah. A little more, the pre-production has to be a bit more lengthier. But never underestimate children, like I told you. She reminds me of them.
Okay. Any other?
Oh, right.
Thank you very much for making this film. I really enjoyed it. My name is Yana.
Thank you.
I was struck by the fact that all characters, except for one, are Indian or Tamil. So this is a Malaysian film, right? But we do basically zoom in on your community. So I was just interested whether this was by design, whether you really just wanted to show the segregation at the time, or whether it just came out naturally. Thanks.
Thank you. It's a very common question from all audiences, international audiences. We get that this for Malaysia, why is it not multicultural? I like to define Malaysia as a multi-racist country. People will correct me quickly. No, it's maturation. No, maturation. So that's what made Malaysia. It's really beautiful. But go back on history. The film was set in 1960s. or what I tried to do achieve post 1960s, yeah, as much as I could. And in the 1960s, if you look back at the history, the British brought in the Indians to serve in certain economic sectors, and one of it was the rubber estates. Yeah. And so a large group of Indian community have a lot of strong connection, you know, to the. But the film in 1960s, of course, the estate was predominantly, you know, Indian, to a certain extent, yeah. And there were other races, but they were performing different sorts of activities. Yeah, like for instance, Archie, who had a tailor shop, you know, or a grocery shop, or you know, some different clusters of job. So this I had to stay here. And it's true, because the estate that I went in there, it's a real estate, it's existing. The community has remained like that. That you know the scene that they walk in, a teacher comes in, it's a white shirt, the teacher comes in, and then he asks these ladies, do you know where Ravi's house is? The three ladies with a banana leaf there, they're holding a banana leaf under the rain, they're walking. They were real people. They were real estate community who were actually passing by while I was shooting, and I said, use them. They were walking with a banana leaf. It wasn't set up. I said, you know what, since we're waiting here for so long and it's raining, the sound is bad, I was taking all live sound quality. And we were sitting under an umbrella and waiting for the rain to go. He said, roll the camera, you know, let's just roll it in this rain and just use them, because they were actually passing by. And so it was a lot, it was real, it was what it was. And so I just documented it as it was and fitted it and improvised it and fitted it with the story. So yeah, it's the context of the story. The context of the story required, you know, an Indian community predominantly. Yes, okay. Sir.
Thank you, my name is David. It would have been very easy to have had a sentimental element to this story. Did you consciously work at not doing that, or did it naturally evolve without any sentimentality?
I didn't get the last part of it.
Did it naturally evolve without any sentimentality, or did you consciously keep sentimentality out of it?
Okay, that's a good question. Yeah. Some have branded me as a fictional documentarist, and I think it was an interesting interpretation of what I do. I have not labeled myself. I just did what I did, and why I prefer to observe more and connect to that emotion. And the most biggest keyword here, I do not like romanticizing anything. I didn't want to blow it out of proportion or, you know, bring that character to exaggerate as much. Again, that was a challenge, because some of my actors had theater background, so they had heavy gestures, and then you cut those gestures down. If they have television background, then that's also quite heavy gestures. But in film, you don't need such heavy gestures. You have a big canvas, big screen, and so that screen tells a story already. So it was not necessary for that you know to amplify aspects that, you know, because the audiences were different, and I've stayed true to them, and I felt as much as could document the real emotions or the real feelings, and it felt right while I looked at it, and I could feel the energy. There's an intuition that I felt the energy. I stopped right there. Yeah. I hope that answers your question. It was a very conscious effort. The actors were so used to watch these television dramas, and especially the Indian ones, with very exaggerated movement. So I tell them, you know, you do not need to use so much exaggeration in delivering this. You just need to be subtle. And it somehow, as we started rolling, it got more and more comfortable, and they did feel fine.
Okay, maybe we will have two more questions.
No, just the location of the film, because it's really nice.
Sungai Buloh. Sungai Buloh is good. Sungai Buloh. It is a rubber research institute of Malaysia.
Yeah.
Sungai Buloh. Sungai Buloh. Rubber Research Institute of Malaysia was the only one few estates that remained those structures.
Oh, the railway station?
I forgot what it is. I think probably Mantin or some plane or somewhere there. We needed the old tracks. But I still didn't get the train from 1960s, so we got the tires shot only. There's wire cables, phone cables, this sort of stuff. I didn't have time to remove the entire infrastructure and leave it. Get out of the story already, you know. So, yeah.
Okay, we open for the last question if you.
Thanks for the film. I was wondering how many days did you shoot? You said that you had to have a longer process of pre-production. So was that pre-production like in the office, or how much of it was on location? Because I'm very curious about your process of working together with non-actors. How did that delay the shoot at all?
Okay, I didn't have any fixed unit of anybody working with us. Everybody came in with different expertise. I just called an audition. I got the crew first. Above the line, we call them people who are really, you know, the producer, executive producer, executive, my father, I can always police, and we need it this way, you know. The script person, the most of the story, I adapted from my mother, and so whenever she came to the scene and said, no, this is not what it was, because I teach the film. My mother has a big family, yeah, there's about 11 or 12 of them. I can't make a telemovie out of this. I got 90 minutes. So I cut down characters, cut down stories, you know, cut down a lot of aspects of it to make it feasible as a film. And so there's a lot of changes here and there that I improvised to get the story going. So as long as that content, so I needed the cast and crew, first of all, when I put together. I needed people who were really committed to the film. Look at payment later, because I didn't have cash at hand. We didn't get anything. We had a pool, we had to go on that. And so anybody who came in and said and showed me a reel or worked with me, I never worked with any of them before this film. So they came together, we said, I looked at them and had a brainstorming session. We somehow worked out, we went on. Yeah. Same with the cast. And so a lot of things had to be, a lot of times, storyboards, scripts, everything had to put together. We had some 280-290 scenes, script as thick as this. But we only managed to shoot less than 200. So there's a lot of scenes missing in there already because we didn't have the time, it just didn't happen. So we just go on. We start shoot some 2 a.m. in the morning, 3 a.m. in the morning. We end some 12, 1 a.m. in the morning. We continuously did it for 14 days. Non-stop, because a lot of dark shots, yeah? The trees were attacked by 4, 3. So due to this, we had time constraints. We had 14 days, and all these people said, I'll give you 14 days, and after which we're gone. I got a day job, I got something else to do. And, you know, the main character, Sarada, also was from Australia. She came in with blonde hair, brown hair, I think burgundy hair. And so I looked at her, I said, this is an estate film, you know, you think you can fit in this film? And she said, I can try, you know. So we took it. But she learned the language. She couldn't speak much fluently initially, but she took the commitment to learn the language, to work with us. To do it, and so that's how we built. People were interested to work with us, and we put a team together. We had 14 days online. So some characters went missing halfway. The boy, he didn't turn up half the shoot, so I had to improvise. So yeah, you had to work with it. There was a lot of, yes, it works, it doesn't work. I had to be realistic about it. And yeah. You have to plan. You have plan B, plan A, plan C. Motorbike, don't start push.
Yeah. What are you doing now?
I'm currently with Marcus Evans Group. We create thought digital platforms. Yeah, training for Africa, Middle East, APAC, Australia. Yeah.
No more movies.
Movies. I left the industry in 2007. I wasn't anyway doing full time movies. You could not do full time movies. I was doing full time research. This movie came into play because I had a research grant from Telecom and I was writing something about identity. And while writing this research in the School of Humanities and Social Sciences about identity, I found out so many things that I thought that also inspired behind, of course, I felt the community was left. And identity, writing about identity in Malaysia, it's a big, big, serious topic. And so it always been like that. I felt that enough research need to be done. You know, in the head, ILHAM is a very expensive venture. It's a very high investment and high risk venture. And if you got to do it, If the purpose isn't right, the vision isn't right, you are not going to be able to sustain this. So that was my drive. It has to be very purposeful, it has to be timely, it has to be important, it has to be needed. Then you go. Then you get this full force commitment. That was how I started. And that's how also I slowed down and fell. I did an economic paper just before, after my second film. And I did a research on the cultural industry and looking at the mapping and the economic returns of this aspect. And I'm glad I didn't move to the next one, because then it would have. This film released in cinema and ran for 3 months, nearly full houses. The cinema told me, if you don't run 1 week with full houses, we got to pull it down. That is the rule everywhere else, yeah? And if you don't run full houses 1 week, you pay for rental of each day of running that aircon and manpower for each of the screens that run. That's the contract I signed. I don't get under the Wajib Tayang or the Malaysian movie. I don't qualify. I pay 25% taxes on each of your tickets. 10 ringgit, 25 government, 60% distributor GSC, 20% exhibitor, 60%, yeah, 20% exhibitor, 1 ringgit comes to me. So why would I want to make films? So yeah, the calculations you've got to make, and then of course you make your break from televisions, paid TV, and whatever else through your RTM. TV Tigger never took my film. They gave me an award, another screen TV Tigger. So that's how it worked. It was a great area that I had to work around because of the language, because of the community I was talking about. There was a barrier of you qualifying as a Malaysian film. And you see, these elements have not worked out over the years. I still people talking about language, what makes a Malaysian film, what not. It's going to take some time. I think if you solve this, you won't be Malaysians anymore. So, so I don't think it'll be easily solved. But it's an interesting aspect of part of what makes the film work.
So you made only these 2 movies?
Only 2. I did a lot of short films, which meant more feasible, were quite successful. But only these 2 features. It was 5. When I started this film, I had 5 in idea. But the 3rd one never got made. Got the script going halfway through, and in 2009, 10, then I did this economic paper and landscape the industry again and landscape everything, and I said this is the good time that I should not try to do this. It does not seem feasible. Yeah, it needs to be very feasible.
Okay, that's one of the.
Is this available?
No, it's not. No distributor as of yet. 12 years. No.
All right, okay. I think that's the all the time that we have. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
And thanks for all of you.